Hey guys, just wanted to take a few minutes here real quick to respond to a video by Jaclyn Glenn. Jaclyn Glenn is a YouTube atheist. She's been on YouTube for several years now, growing in her audience. Back whenever I first discovered her, she probably had 200,000 subscribers. Now she's got like 720,000. So I just wanted to take a few minutes to respond to her on a video titled Disproving Christianity. Let's see what she's got.
Hey guys, so today I want to make a video Disproving Christianity. By far, the biggest question that I get from people is asking me to prove to them that there's no God.
So there's really no nice way to say this, but why are people going to a random chick on YouTube seeking to have Christianity disproved? I mean, haven't people been trying to do this for, I don't know, 2,000 years? What about other atheists like, I don't know, Friedrich Nietzsche or Voltaire or David Hume? Or what about the modern ones, the four horsemen of atheism? You got Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, Christopher Hitchens, and Daniel Dennett. What about these guys? Why are they coming to this girl on YouTube?
By far, the biggest question that I get from people is asking me to prove to them that there's no God, which is an impossible thing to ask for somebody to do because it's impossible to disprove a negative.
Whenever I first heard her say this, I thought, oh, she's one of them, because that is just a talking point that she is regurgitating. And besides, she didn't even say it right. It's not that people are saying that it's impossible to disprove a negative. What they say is that it's impossible to prove a negative. So in this case, it would be to prove that God doesn't exist. But the thing about it is, it's not even true. It is possible to prove a negative. This happens all the time. You can do it through means of lack of evidence. Like, we can prove that there is no invisible planet between the Earth and Mars because we would be able to pick up on it because of other things. Like, there should be evidence if this thing existed. There is no evidence of it, therefore we can conclude it doesn't. This does happen, but it also happens in the case of a logical contradiction. So we know that there are no square circles. We know that there are no married bachelors, for instance, etc., etc. So it is possible to prove a negative, but she doesn't even say it right. She says disprove a negative, but that's the same as proving a positive.
But what I feel like I can do is I have a mountain of evidence against the Christian version of God and Christianity, and that's what I'm going to try to present to you in this video. I'm going to do it in the nicest way that I possibly can without being condescending or anything like that.
To her credit, she actually does accomplish this. If you see her other videos, she basically makes an audience off being inflammatory and crazy, so well done.
But this video I want to kind of aim at everyone, Christians, non-Christians, people on the fence, everyone, so that you guys can get an idea of where I'm coming from and why I'm not a Christian anymore. A lot of it is the same reasons.
What's ironic about this is she said the stuff that she's about to go over is the reason that she's not a Christian anymore, but I've seen her earlier stuff and I know that's not true. She's not a Christian anymore because she was basically pushed out of it through various circumstances in her past. It was an emotional thing. It wasn't based on any of the stuff that she's about to go over. Maybe it solidified her atheism, but it's not what caused it.
I said I want to make this a nice video. But first of all, you know, you can't prove there's no God.
I touched on this a little bit earlier, but she says she can't prove that God doesn't exist. Theoretically, you can prove God doesn't exist if you are able to show that God as defined is logically contradictory. The concept of him is logically contradictory. And people have tried to do this, I mean, for centuries and centuries. I mean, Epicurus, way back in like the ancient Greek times, he had his formulation. You have the Euthyphro dilemma, you know, does God command what is good, or is it good because God commands it? These things were set out to show that the concept of God was self-contradictory in some way.
But people have also asked me to prove that atheism is true. Now, first of all, I want to clarify really quick that atheism is not a religion, it's the lack of a religion.
While it is true that atheism isn't a religion, it's also not defined as the lack of religion, because agnosticism would also be a lack of religion, but it is a different school of thought than atheism, and there are other systems of thought as well.
I mean, everyone is technically, and this is a famous quote, everyone's technically an atheist for every other religion except for their own. Like, why don't you believe in Zeus? Why don't you believe in Thor? Why don't you believe in, you know, flying spaghetti monster, etc.? I mean, people don't believe in any other religion except for their own, so atheists are said to just take it one step further.
I believe she's quoting Stephen Roberts here, whose original quote is, "I contend that we are both atheists. I just believe in one fewer God than you do." Now, the problem with this is that it doesn't understand how words work, namely the word atheism. Atheism or atheist is a universal qualifier. One is not an atheist against particular gods, right? So I am not an atheist against Zeus. Atheist is a universal qualifier, meaning your worldview has no gods in it. There is no God in your worldview. None. So, as a Christian, I am not an atheist against Zeus. Being a Christian already implies that I don't believe in Zeus. So it may seem like a good quote to regurgitate, but it really doesn't make any sense.
Now, when a lot of people make videos like this, they try to disprove Christianity by pointing out all the negative things that they see in the Bible. Like they point out the bigotry and the hate and the misogyny and quotes about how homosexuals are, you know, the worst thing ever and how, you know, rape is okay.
Even if we were to accept that the Bible promotes all kinds of immorality like she's laying out here, does that disprove that it's true? Like, theoretically, could not all that stuff be in the Bible and Christianity still be true? It's a non sequitur.
You know, that's often countered by Christians by saying, well, there's also a lot of good things in the Bible, but they like to cherry pick and they don't focus on the contradictions. They don't focus on the negative things because they say Jesus is there and Jesus is good and the Old Testament isn't so relevant. But the thing is that Jesus verifies everything in the Old Testament.
Ugh, so this is incredibly sloppy, and I'm not going to go the no true Scotsman thing because I do believe she actually was a Christian, I just don't believe she was very well read in it. And I'm also not going to say that's why she left Christianity. I'm not going to go there, I'm just saying this is incredibly sloppy for somebody who used to be a Christian. No, we do not counter things by saying, hey, I know there's all that bad, but what about all this good? No, we don't do that. We like to take the objections head on and discuss what's the cultural context, what's the grammatical context behind that because it wasn't written in English. Let's take all the variables into account and check it out, see what is actually going on. There's numerous videos and different teachings on this if somebody really wanted to go in with an open mind and see what the actual defense is of a lot of this stuff. Contradictions, once again, let's take it head on. I don't believe there are contradictions, so let's examine them one by one. I don't ignore them. I want to see what they are and we can discuss them. And we're also not saying ignore all that because, hey, we have Jesus and the Old Testament isn't relevant anymore. There are certain aspects of the Old Testament that were done away with after the crucifixion of Jesus. We are no longer under the law, for example, but that's not saying that all that bad stuff doesn't count anymore. It's saying that it has been subverted by a better thing, that namely the resting in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, not being under the law. And Jesus verified the Old Testament. What he said is he's not there to abolish the law, he's there to fulfill the law. And atheists like to harp on this a lot in my experience to say, hey, all this stuff under the law, it is still supposed to be followed today. No, it's not.
And also, there's no such thing as hell, really, until you get to the New Testament. So everybody who sits there and says that the New Testament is this like warm and fuzzy thing, it's not necessarily true because that's where hell kind of started. And that's not the most, you know, maybe warm, but not exactly fuzzy thing that I could think of.
And of course, it's not that hell didn't show up until the New Testament. That's not how it worked historically. In the Old Testament, they did not have the full idea of hell that we do through the New Testament, but that's because of this thing called doctrinal development. The Old Testament didn't even have Satan completely fleshed out yet until the New Testament, because what happens is over the centuries, these doctrines develop as God is sovereign over the whole process to bring truth to us gradually. Then you have the intertestamental period, and then you have the New Testament. So even in the Old Testament, there was some concept of hell, and it was fleshed out basically as everyone goes to Sheol. That is the abode of the dead. When you die, you go to Sheol, but it is the hope of the righteous that one day you get out. So no, hell didn't just suddenly appear in the New Testament.
You already know that there's a number of contradictions in the Bible, and to sit here and go through all of them would be an impossible feat. Like, I would be here all day. I don't think I could make a video long enough to go through the entire Bible and point out every single thing that's contradictory. But you guys can go ahead and Google that on your own, because, I mean, you just type it in Google, a billion things will come up.
And this right there should point out the quality of argumentation you're going to get from her and her channel, because she is simply relying on Google. She says, hey, I could be here all day. I can't make a video long enough to go through all the contradictions in the Bible, so just go Google it. You know what? That's what she's probably doing. Just Googling Bible contradictions and then going off that without any real research. Is she submitting these to Christians and say, hey, this seems contradictory in your Bible. What do you say about this? What about theologians? What about other Bible scholars? Does she submit it to them? No. What she does is that she Googles it because she already has this preconceived notion that there are contradictions in the Bible, and she just goes off that. And for her audience, she doesn't say, hey, look these up yourself by reading the Bible and subjecting it to scrutiny. She says, just Google it.
But one thing I do want to point out, it's not so much a contradiction, it's just something in the Bible that's just bizarre. There are different points in there where it references a flat earth. They say that the earth is flat, and they also make references to the earth being the center of the universe where other planets would revolve around the earth.
So this is a little embarrassing on her part because she just got done telling people, hey, just go Google it. Did she not think to do it with what she just said here? Because nowhere in the Bible does it say the earth is flat, as she just implied. Now, there are certain verses that people debate over. That's fine. There's two schools of thought within Christianity. One school of thought will say, no, the Bible authors didn't think the earth was flat. You were just misreading the passage. The other school of thought is that, yeah, the authors thought the earth was flat, but they're not teaching that. They're actually teaching a bigger theological point, and that is what the biblical author is trying to portray. He just used what he knew at the time to get that thought across, and yeah, we know now that it's not flat, but that wasn't his point anyway, so the Bible is still divinely inspired. God just didn't feel like he needed to correct their science. No matter which school of thought you fall within, the point is that the Bible doesn't say the earth is flat. It doesn't teach that. And also she says that the Bible says that it's the center of the universe and the planets revolve around it. The Bible says nothing about planets revolving, ever.
And talking about the story of Jesus and why I don't believe it. And it's not that I don't think that there was a man named Jesus that existed. That could have been very well, you know, that's fine. That has nothing to do with my point. The point is that if you look at history, there are so many stories, mythological stories, before Jesus that had almost the same exact storyline that he had.
So this is the part of the video where she is going to show us the fruit of all her Google searches in regards to the story of Jesus and whether or not he is a copy of pagan god myths. But one thing you will see that is suspiciously absent from this is any reference to any original historical sources on these matters.
There's stories of several different gods that were born of a virgin, that were human yet divine. Their father was even a carpenter, but their real father was God. They were brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh by wise men on their birthday, December 25th, which is the winter solstice. They all had that in common. They were the savior, the messiah, the way, the truth, the light. They brought salvation to people. They died as a martyr, some even on a cross, and rose from the dead, ascended into heaven. And that story is not unique to Jesus.
I don't need to spend a lot of time on this because she didn't talk about any specific gods that, you know, this all described, and she also didn't give any resources to check out. She just made a bunch of claims and says that, hey, so the story of Jesus isn't unique. What I can say, though, is that I have studied this for quite a while over the years, and I can say that everything she just said is complete rubbish. It is not true. Especially stuff like, take for instance, she says they were all born on December 25th. Well, look at the story of Horus that she's going to go over. He was born on December 25th. Yeah, but then you'll realize that the people who are claiming he was born on December 25th, they'll also say, oh, well, he was born every day because it had to do with the rising of the sun, so he was reborn every single day. So that included December 25th. Everything she just said is on par with that kind of reasoning. And so whenever you look at the original sources and the people making these claims to say, hey, it's just like Jesus, it all falls flat.
So the first god I want to go over is Horus. It was a god that was written about in the Egyptian Book of the Dead in 1280 BC, and here are some of the similarities. First of all, he was a son of God.
Well, there were numerous gods in the Egyptian pantheon of gods, and these gods had children. So being a child of one of these gods is hardly unique. But it's a far cry from saying you're the only son of the one true god of a monotheistic religion.
Some people disagree whether or not he was born of a virgin, but that's in some stories of him.
This is simply not true. There is not one single Egyptologist that believes that Horus was born of a virgin. There are different renditions of how Horus was conceived. One of them was through the union of Osiris and his wife Isis just before Set killed Osiris. That was sexual reproduction. The other one is the same thing happened, but it was just after Set killed Osiris and scattered pieces of him, which Isis then reconstructed, and she created a new phallus for him that she got pregnant through. So it was sexual reproduction, however you split it. Some resources for that, the civilizations of the ancient Near East. There's also the Encyclopedia of Religion, Volume 7. I would check those out if you want some original sources on that matter.
And he was baptized in a river. He was tempted in the desert. He healed the sick, cured the blind, cast out demons, walked on water.
Well, the burden of proof is on her for these because I can't find any evidence that these describe the god Horus. I'm just going to chalk it up to it being one of those things where there's very incredibly loosely based parallels that are kind of not really that similar that they are claiming are the exact same thing. For instance, maybe Horus once bathed in a river and they're saying, haha, he was baptized. That's the kind of shoddy scholarship that's behind these claims. But once again, the burden of proof is on her.
He raised someone named Asar, A-S-A-R, from the dead, and that actually literally translates to Lazarus.
That isn't even close to being true. Asar, A-S-A-R, that's a transliteration of Osiris, not Lazarus. And Osiris was not brought back by Horus, he was brought back by Isis, briefly, so that she could conceive Horus. So this isn't even close to true.
He had 12 disciples, he was crucified, and rose from the dead 3 days later.
Once again, this is incredibly factually inaccurate. So, did Horus have 12 disciples? No. This connection is made because there is an Egyptian mural called the 12 who reap the harvest, but Horus is not appearing in that mural, and it's not tied to Horus whatsoever. But they are taking that and saying, oh, those were his 12 disciples. There are also times where Horus had other followers, but it never added up to 12. So they're basically taking two points that aren't connected and trying to connect them to say he had 12 disciples. Was Horus crucified? No, he wasn't. There are some depictions of him in cruciform position that's standing there with his arms out, but that has nothing to do with crucifixion. And did he raise after 3 days? There's no reference to him being raised from the dead after 3 days. What happened is, he died as a child only to be brought back to life because his grieving mother went to some animal-headed god of magic. It had something to do with that. But Jesus, this doesn't parallel Jesus whatsoever.
That's just a few things. They didn't have that much in common.
Honestly, that's quite the understatement. They basically had nothing in common. So the next god she's going to talk about is Krishna. For this, and for the sake of brevity, I am going to put in a snippet from a video by Ben Stanhope and his channel Pixels and Papyrus, because he explains it way better than I could, and he has more access to the original sources to lay this out. So here's his take on it.
But anyways, the next god I want to talk to you about is Krishna. Here are a few things that they had in common. Both the Son of God, both sent from heaven to earth in the form of a man, both called the Savior.
Richard Carrier and scholars like Benjamin Walker have pointed out that Hindu texts like the Bhagavata Purana and the Harivamsa written around the 6th to 7th centuries AD do in fact synchronize certain Christian ideas with Hindu religion. Those late parallels are in part what Jaclyn's sources will be referring to. But here's a challenge. Of the thousands of scholars publishing, quote me a single living New Testament or historical Jesus scholar holding a university position on the face of the planet that thinks that Krishna worship was a source influence on the historical Jesus. Name a single one. Do you seriously believe that a first century Pharisee like Paul got his idea about a crucified Messiah literally over 2,000 miles away from a blue guy in a polytheistic pantheon? Especially considering our undisputed Paulines like Galatians claim that Paul knew Jesus' own brother, James, and spent time with some of the disciples.
His adoptive father was a human and a carpenter.
Keith Thompson claims that he contacted Vasudha Narayanan, a distinguished professor of religion with a PhD in Hinduism at the University of Bombay, and he asked her about this claim regarding Krishna. Quote, to the best of my knowledge, his father was not a carpenter, more like a prince. I can't imagine why people would sit back and cook up all these conspiracies. She also made it clear that Krishna's mother Devaki wasn't a virgin, since she was married to Vasudeva, and the whole myth centers around Krishna escaping the infanticide imposed on his 7 older siblings.
The second person of the Trinity.
Your sources are talking about something called the Hindu Trimurti. The Trimurti shows up in a few places in the Puranas, which are composed hundreds of years after the Christian doctrine of the Trinity had already been established. We know where Jews got their Trinity doctrine from. Scholars like Daniel Boyarin and Benjamin Sommer have shown that it is an extension of Second Temple Semitic divine fluidity, specifically Shekinah embodiment theology. Imagine my shock, Christianity developed out of Second Temple Jewish theology. I'm sorry if that's boring.
Both celebrated a Last Supper. Both forgave his enemies. Both descended into hell and were resurrected. Many people witnessed their ascensions into heaven.
Dr. Edwin Bryant, professor of Hinduism at Rutgers University, is the translator of the Bhagavata Purana for Penguin World Classics. He was asked about this claim and responded by referring to the Mahabharata, where Krishna was shot in the foot by a hunter named Jara by accident. After this, he died. His spirit, not his body, then ascended. Bryant stated that there was no resurrection and that his followers who came to see him could not see his spirit ascending.
And that brings me to the last god, Mithra. Mithras was a Roman god. He was the savior. He was sent to earth to live as a mortal. He died for our sins so that sinners could have everlasting life.
From what I can see, there's not really any evidence of this, but it's also not uncommon for gods in mythology to offer immortality, so not really much parallel there.
But of course, course he was resurrected from the dead.
I couldn't find any evidence that Mithras was ever even depicted as dying, let alone resurrecting, but I did see something about Tertullian writing about Mithraic people displaying scenes of resurrection or something like that. But this was an ancient church father well after the New Testament, so if there was any copying, it was most likely the Mithras people copying Christianity, not the other way around.
He was born from a virgin on December 25th. And guess what? He was born in a manger with lots of shepherds, and they referred to him as the light of the world.
Mithras was actually known as the rock-born god. So unless we want to say that he was born of a virgin because the rock from which he emerged from was a virgin as well, there is no parallel here, and there's really no sense in saying he was born of a virgin. Now, the December 25th thing, I do believe that he may have been celebrated on December 25th, but this has no connection to Christianity because that thought didn't even emerge until the 4th century within Christian circles. So it's not a parallel by any means. But it does appear that there is some evidence that Mithras had shepherds present to help pull him out of the rock, but this tradition didn't emerge until after 100 years after the New Testament. So if there's borrowing, it's likely the Mithras people borrowing from Christianity.
He also had 12 disciples, and they also had a Last Supper before he died.
There's actually no evidence that Mithras had 12 disciples. The closest we can get is depictions of Mithras within the 12 signs of the zodiac. If you want to make that connection, go ahead, but even that is post-Christian in its depiction, so there's literally no connection that could be made there. As for the Last Supper, yes, the followers of Mithras did have fellowship meals, but that's hardly a parallel. That was probably actually very common.
Now, a lot of different religious scholars will debate certain aspects of these different gods and say, well, that wasn't true and that wasn't true, but you can't begin to debate them all. You can't say that there's no credibility for any of them being historically accurate, and historically accurate as saying that's how the people viewed that particular god. You can't dispute every single claim.
Actually, you can dispute every claim, and I did, and so have many other people for literally two centuries now whenever this stuff was brought up.
The point is these three gods had so much in common with the story of Jesus. All came before him.
Actually, when you dig into all this, you see that there really are no parallels. And if there does seem to be somewhat of a striking parallel between Jesus and one of these other gods, what you find out is the original source for these other gods is post-Christian. So, no, there is no verifiable parallel of Christianity borrowing from these gods. That's pretty much all Jaclyn says that I wanted to address in this video. If you want to see what she goes on to say, I have a link to her original video in the description. She basically just goes on to say that she doesn't understand how people could ignore this. You know, if you want to ignore this or that about Christianity, that's fine, but you can't ignore this. Christianity was obviously plagiarized. She talks about how she just discovered this recently and doesn't understand why more people aren't talking about it, although it's weird that she just discovered it relatively recently, as she says, but then she also said all this stuff was a straw that broke the camel's back to her faith, like years before that. Whatever, I'll ignore that part too. I just wanted to take this time to talk about where she's pulling this from. There's this documentary that came out several years ago called Zeitgeist, and it sought to show that Jesus was a plagiarism of other gods in the ancient world that came before him. And Horus, Mithras, and Krishna were three of those gods. Far be it for me to try to debunk that entire documentary, but people have done that. You have Elliot Nesh, Chris White has also taken it on. I'll link to their videos in the description as well. The last point I wanted to make about this video is something I find highly ironic, and it's when she says this.
This is something that whenever I found out the details of this was completely shocking to me. I felt pissed. I felt like I had been tricked my whole life, and it was kind of the straw that broke the camel's back, kind of saying it was the last straw for me. Like I after seeing all the similarities between Jesus and gods before him, it was like, what is the point of believing any of it anymore?
So I wanted to point this out because Jaclyn says that she felt like she had been lied to her whole life, and then goes on to say that she felt like she was tricked and that she was angry because of it. But how ironic is it that everything she just said is basically a lie? So the straw that broke the camel's back of her faith was itself a lie. I find that highly ironic and quite unfortunate that things like this that are so easily disproven could cause such a rift in someone's faith, if she is being honest about that being the straw that broke the camel's back. I'm highly suspicious of that. But one has to ask the question, why aren't any credible historical scholars in high positions also talking about this stuff? The reason she's not seeing this as widespread knowledge is because it's basically just rubbish. And I hope that anybody who's watching this video, look into the original sources, look at what people are saying, talk to scholars if you really want to dig into it, and you'll find out that Jesus was not a plagiarism of ancient gods. That's all I got for you guys today. Please let me know what you think in the comments section, whether you like it, whether you hated it, whether you wanted to commend it or dispute anything in it. I'd love to hear from you, but you guys have a great day. See ya.